don't we, huh? Welcome back, girl. Now here is the Orioles starting lineup for the opening day. Leadoff man in the second baseman, number two, Alan Wiggins. Batting second, playing in right field, number 27, Lee Lacy. In the third position, the Orioles all-star shortstop, number eight, Cal Ripken. I think you know who comes next. I haven't heard it for a long time. Let me hear it. LD, LD. In the fifth position, the distinguished veteran and perennial all-star, number 19, Fred Lynn. As designated hitter today, an outstanding young man who came into his own last year, number 43, Mike Young. This could be the happiest man on the field today. Hitting in the number seven position, wearing number 37, Oriole left fielder John Shelby. Batting in the eighth position, catching in game number 1,102 for the Orioles, here is number 24, Rick Betsy. Playing third base, welcome another newcomer to our fair city, number 11, Jackie Gutierrez. Warming up in the left field bullpen with Elrod, the Orioles' fourth biggest all-time winner, number 46, starting pitcher, Mike Flanagan. Before we go any farther, we would like to take this opportunity to thank the Sun Paper for the survival kit that we all received here this afternoon.
Ken, it looks like the president is making his way down 33rd Street at this moment.
That's the limo, and he should be entering directly behind us, so we should have a fairly good picture of the presidential limousine.
There's the limousine right now with the presidential seal. And he looks enthused. I can see through the bulletproof glass that there's an enthused baseball fan sitting back there.
We'll have to get him an Orioles cap. If you want to hobnob with the president, you have to come out to 33rd Street today. And he's waving to the crowd. They wave back.
And it's beautifully timed.
It certainly is.
Just in time for the first pitch. And a hot dog or two. He is making his way into the stadium now, and I assume that they have built him a nice little exclusive section to watch the game for, and I bet he wouldn't have come if it was raining, but that's all right. We'll take fair weather.
I can't see our monitor here. I'm not sure what picture we have. There we go. Can you see him? Yeah.
There he is, making his way into
the
stadium.
Welcome, Mr. President.
Welcome back to Baltimore, Mr. President. We missed you last year.
That's right.
Adding to the list of many, the diehard baseball fans and Orioles fans.
Hey, this is going to be quite a day and quite a season for the Orioles. I think we're looking for big things.
I'm ready to go watch the game and for you to buy me lunch. So I think it's time.
I don't know about lunch, but I'm ready to go watch the game.
I've got witnesses, Matt. The time is right, the place is right, and the team is right. Baseball's back, and we are all set for the opening day first pitch.
That's right. So on behalf of the entire Channel 2 News team, thanks for joining us. We'll be right back with Chuck and Brooks, and Orioles baseball is next, and we'll see you for the news around about 5 o'clock tonight.
Orioles on Deck, opening day 1986, has been brought to you in part by Oldsmobile. There is a special feel in an Oldsmobile. By Carrier. Carrier invented air conditioning and keeps on inventing it. by Beck's, the most famous German word in the English language, and by Jack's Corned Beef, bringing all the deli delights of Lombard Street to your neighborhood. This WMAR-TV special has been a presentation of Channel 2 News.
Again, they're trying to open up a pathway so Ronald Reagan will be able to throw his traditional fastball as he has done before to Rick Dempsey. We just have one of those scenes, however, when reporters and cameramen just aren't cooperating for the moment. And now Reagan is chatting with Rick Dempsey. And now young Brian Gray will be the first to throw one. Brian from Johns Hopkins Children's Center. Looks like Brian is a right-hander. Again, the commissioner was asked, and he deferred to a youngster from the Children's Center. And, of course, so did President Reagan. Rick Dempsey says he's ready, and there's the first pitch. And now President Reagan will take his first pitch as Dempsey backs up a little. And Reagan warns the reporters to move aside. I might be a little wild. The crowd just loves it. And Reagan throws one over Dempsey's head and back towards the backstop. But he's got another ball. He's going to try again. This time he's going to try to get it right. Now the sun is beginning to break through. Reagan has again told the reporters to back up. And now he'll give it another try. And there's a changeup. And that one made it. So the first ball has been thrown out. The crowd loving it. The weather is clearing. It's a beautiful day for baseball in Baltimore. We will be back with more after these messages. Jewelers' time is 2:11. 1986 marks K. Jewelers' 70th year of service in the Baltimore, Washington area. With over 275 stores nationally, K. Jewelers, the Diamond People, featuring the Wittenauer watch. The umpires, Joe Brinkman behind the plate, Terry Cooney is at first base, Steve Palermo at second, and Ken Kaiser is at third. And now as we get underway in the 1986 season, here with a play-by-play of today's game is John Miller. John?
Thank you very much, Tom, and again, a very pleasant good afternoon, everyone, wherever you may be. And more than 50,000 of you are right here at Memorial Stadium, we know that for sure. Mike Flanagan, under blue skies with some scattered cloudiness, although the sun itself is not shining on the ballpark right now. We do have bright blue skies just directly overhead. And temperatures in the upper 60s, 67 degrees at game time. Brett Butler, Joe Carter, and Julio Franco will be the first three Indian batters against Mike Flanagan, who is making his first opening day start since 1978. Flanagan worked against the Milwaukee Brewers in Milwaukee to open that season, losing 11-3 to the Brewers, part of a crazy weekend for the Orioles at that time. Flanagan, who has made a long trip back and hoping now to produce a productive season for the Orioles. Last year was virtually a washout for him, coming back from the Achilles tendon injury, which could have ended his career, but a tribute to Flanagan's tenacity is that he's here today making this opening day start. The first pitch to Brett Butler, a little bit outside for ball one. And at 2:12 p.m., we are underway. Butler, a left-hand batter, a 300 hitter last year, a good bunter. And he squares the bunt, takes a curve, and that one misses somewhere. Ball two, 2-0. Both pitches very close. John Gorrell is the third base coach for the Indians, and Bobby Bonds is coaching over at first. Third baseman Gutierrez very shallow for Butler. Flanagan's 2-0 delivery. And that's low, ball three. And looked like Brinkman almost started to call that one a strike. Flanagan looks a little bit upset right now. 3-0 the count, all very close pitches. The outfield bunched up toward the left field line. Here comes Butler. Bluffs the bunt, takes a strike, and the count now 3-1. Butler has had 49 bunts for hits in the last 2 years, so he's one of the best at that in the American League. Here it comes. He bunts this one, third base side, but it rolls foul. 3-2. The field is in very good shape considering the weather we've had here over the weekend, as the Orioles were in Florida and having weather that was in and out for the last couple of weeks, getting a lot of rain down there. Up here, it was beautiful, as you well know, until this weekend when the rains came. And it rained a good part of yesterday and during the night and even this morning some. So the outfield is wet. The infield is too. And a bunter like Butler might be helped by that. The pitch to him, slashed foul outside of third and on down the left field line. 3-2 the count. The Orioles have Flanagan on the mound and Dempsey the catcher. Murray at first base, Wiggins at second, Ripken at short, Gutierrez at third. Around the outfield, Shelby, Lynn, and Lacey from left to right. Butler in a wide open stance, the pitch to him. And a blooper hit foul down the left field line. And this one will drop back into the seats about four rows deep. Back beyond the black and orange bunting, which is right along the box seat railing down there. Wind is blowing out toward right field. Again, Flanagan winds. The 3-2 pitch to Butler. Very high and inside. He walked it. Flanagan this spring pitched 33 innings and walked only four all spring.
Batting second. The right fielder.
Brett Butler coaxes a number walk three, out of him. And here is Joe Carter. And Butler, the man who makes the Indians go, stole 47 bases last year, so he's a threat to run at any time. Eddie Murray will hold him on the bag at first. Now the sun has broken through. Joe Carter, powerful right-hand batter. Had a lot of injury troubles last year, nonetheless managed to hit 15 home runs. Throw to first, and Butler is back. The Indians had spring training out in Arizona, and they did a lot of heavy hitting out there. Cleveland hit 315 this spring. Now the pitch. Line drive down the left field line. It's a fair ball. Bounces off the railing and becomes lodged in beneath some of the bunting out there. Shelby has to chase after it. Ending up at third is Butler, and at second, Carter with a double. And we never got a sign for any kind of a ground rule double. Shelby looking in, and at third base umpire Ken Kaiser wanted to know about that one. The ball became lodged in the area where the railing comes right out to the seats where the grounds crew is ensconced. And Shelby was waiting to play the carom off that railing, and it never came to him. Now Earl Weaver out to the mound with Dempsey and Flanagan. And Eddie Murray, meanwhile, is over with the first base umpire, Terry Cooney. And Eddie asking Cooney what's going on, and now Eddie's nodding his head. When I said the bunting down there, that was a guess because I can't see that railing. I just know that it's there. But there is bunting all the way around. Could be that the bunting is just in play. Now here's Julio Franco. The Indians lost 102 games a year ago, but despite all of the losing, it was primarily the pitching which cost them. Their hitting was pretty good, and Franco was the best of all. He delivered 90 RBIs. Flanagan turns over a fastball, misses outside with it for ball one. The Oriole bullpen is busy already. Rich Borde, right-hander, is starting to throw out there. Runners at second and third. The Oriole infield back in normal depth. Flanagan throws. Little tapper hits slowly. Third base side. It's a fair ball. Gutierrez fields it. Throws, and he got him. And the runners hold. A little roller along the third baseline that looked for sure like it was going to go foul, and it never did. Pat Satterone keeps the grass cut right next to the foul line here, and as a result of that, that ball stayed fair. It hit the grass just as it started to spin toward the line and redirected its course, or at least seemed to. And Gutierrez charged it, one-handed it, and we get an early look at that great arm of his. So Franco is retired. Franco seemed to be surprised when he got to first base that the ball had not gone foul. One out now. Here is Andre Thornton. Frank Robinson from the dugout adjusting the outfield defense. Slow curve to Thornton is grounded foul, third base side. This is what Thornton has paid for, and he's paid quite handsomely for these kind of spots. Last year, in the second half of the season, he began to deliver. Thornton had 71 RBIs in the second half of the season a year ago. Had a terrible first half. One out. Here's the pitch. Screwball is swung on and missed. And that's a new one from Flanagan. He worked on it this spring, and Thornton missed it by a foot. 0-2 the count. Thornton steps way out of the batter's box and collects his thoughts after that one. Brooke Jacoby is on deck. The threesome of Franco, Thornton, and Jacoby, all delivered from 87 to 90 RBIs a year ago. Butler down the line from third, Carter away from second. Wiggins pulled over and playing right behind second base. The outfield very deep and around toward left. Lacey in right field and very deep right center. Now Thornton backs away. No score with one out. Flanagan in early trouble trying to work his way out of it. Now he's ready. The two-strike delivery and a slow curve drops low and inside for a ball. Thornton, triggering those last two pitches, both looked awfully funny, asks the plate umpire, Joe Brinkman, to inspect that baseball. Brinkman does so. Rubs it up a little bit and sends it right back to Flanagan. Now Thornton, big, strong, right-hand batter, stands back in. Got an even stance, hunched over a little bit at the waist, well off the plate. Flanny from the stretch, delivers. There's a one-hopper to shortstop. Heading home is Butler, and heading for third is Carter. Ripken throws to third for the out. Butler scores, Thornton safe at first, but Joe Carter breaking for third was an easy out. Very bad decision by Carter.
Number 26.
A run has scored. Thornton is aboard on the fielder's choice, and Carter is thrown out at third from 6-5. The Orioles kept the infield back, and Thornton able to pick up a run batted in as a result of that. Now here's Brooke Jacoby, right-hand batter. The pitch to him, swinging a foul straight back, and it's 0-1. Jacoby hit 20 homers last year and drove in 87 RBIs. Corrales hoping for even bigger things this year. Jacoby, three homers and 12 RBIs against the Orioles. The pitch. Ground ball wide of third. To his left is Gutierrez. He gobbles it up, throws to Wiggins at second. Thornton is forced and the Indians are gone. And all things considered, Flanagan gets out of it very easily. One run, one hit, and one left. After a half inning, Cleveland won. The Orioles are coming up. Now the Orioles in the last of the first inning, trailing 1-0, and coming up against right-hander Ken Strom. Alan Wiggins, Lee Lacy, and Cal Ripken, the first three Orioles due up. Strom with the Minnesota Twins last year. He's 31 years old, 6 feet 2 inches tall, throws a lot of off-speed stuff. And Schramm, 9-12 with the Twins last year, a 4.99 earned run average. Gave up 28 home runs in only 161 innings. But 20 of those 28 were given up in the Metrodome. And he's hopeful, as are the Indians, that he'll give up a lot fewer than that in his new home in Cleveland. And he is the opening day starter for the Indians. Phil Niekro, just acquired a few days ago, will not pitch in this series, but will pitch the home opener for the Indians in Cleveland on Friday against the Detroit Tigers.
The second baseman, number 2, Alan Wiggins.
Here come the Orioles with Wiggins at the plate. Wiggins hit 285 a year ago. Switch hitter, he'll bat left-handed. Cal Ripken, the third base coach. Jimmy Williams is coaching over at first. Third baseman Jacoby, very shallow in on the grass for the Indians. The pitch to Wiggins. And he turns to bunt, takes a fastball, called a strike on the inside. He pulled back from it, but the count is 0-1. The outfield, shallow and over toward the left field line. Schramm into his windup, and he throws. There's a fly ball along the left field line, and to his right toward the line goes Mel Hall to make the catch. One away, and here's Lee Lacy.
Batting second, the right fielder.
The first game to get started today in Detroit, the Red Sox and the Tigers, with Bruce Hurst for the Red Sox, Jack Morris for the Tigers, and the very first pitch of the very first game of 1986 was hit for a home run by Dwight Evans against Morris, and Boston is leading 1-0 after an inning and a half now in Detroit. Here's the pitch to Lacy. Curveball foul back right toward us. And just a bit below into the camera area. 0-1 the count. the traditional National League opener in Cincinnati, Philadelphia, and the Reds. And the Phillies have three runs on the board already, still batting in the first against Mario Soto. Curve is low to Lacy, 1-1. Three runs are in with two out, Phillies still batting. Steve Carlton will be the opening day pitcher for the Phillies. Here's the 1-1 pitch to Lacy. Ground ball wide of third, into the hole and into left field, base hit. Cal Ripken. Lacy just rolled that one right through the hole, and Julio Franco, ranging far to his right, just couldn't quite come up with it. So Lacy has the base hit, and here's Cal Ripken. What a spring Cal had. 337, six homers, 16 RBIs in Florida. Last year, a career record, 110 RBIs for Cal. 26 home runs. Cleveland ahead 1-0, one out and one on for the Orioles in the first. Tabler at first, holding Lacy, Schramm to Ripken. Fastball runs inside, ball one. And Eddie Murray comes out on deck. Looks like the president is still down there in the Orioles dugout, and a lot of photographers down there adjacent to the dugout with their lenses pointed into the dugout. A lot of people not normally allowed in the dugout, surrounding the dugout area. 1-0 pitch, and it's in there for a called strike. One ball and one strike. When the president threw out the first ball here in 1984, he stayed down there for the first inning and a half or so with Orioles owner Edward Bennett Williams and various dignitaries. And a hot dog vendor came down, and the president wanted four hot dogs. Here's the stretch now by Schramm. Bluffs Lacy back at first. So they gave him the four hot dogs. The president said, I'll get it. He reached in and gave the guy a five. And the vendor said, that's $8, Mr. President. I've only got the five. I don't know if the guy called for ballpark security or not. Have this bum thrown out. 1-1. Somebody loaned him the money. Hot dogs have gone up since Dutch used to broadcast. There's a liner into center field. Here comes Butler. It's hanging up long enough, and Butler is able to get to it for the catch. Out number two, Lacy going back to first, and here is Eddie Murray. Eddie got it going the last week of spring training, and Earl Weaver was happy to see it happen. Eddie missed about 10 days of the spring trying to rehabilitate his sprained ankle, an injury that had occurred in January in one of the Orioles' charity basketball games. Murray batting left-handed. He, too, set a career record last year with 124 RBIs. The pitch to him. Sinker is low for ball one. The outfield deep and pulled around toward right field. Looks like the sun is going to be in and out throughout the day. It is out right now. Here's the stretch and the pitch. Slow curveball, and Murray way out in front of it. He missed it. Strike one. One ball, one strike. Murray with a dramatic two-run homer to break a 2-2 tie and give the Orioles a victory in the eighth inning of the home opener last year against Texas. Lacy at first, the pitch. There's a one-hopper to second. Bernazar to his right to get it. Flips over to Tabler at first, and the side is retired. One hit, one left at the end of one. Cleveland won, the Orioles nothing. Cleveland won, the Orioles nothing. This is John Miller along with Tom Marr at Memorial Stadium. Just us and 52,000 very close friends. Here's the pitch to Tabler, right-hand batter. Flanny pours it in there for a strike. It's 0-1. Tabler, a 275 hitter a year ago, although he missed the last month of the season. He had some arthroscopic surgery on his knee. Tough clutch hitter, particularly with the bases loaded. The one-strike delivery. Fastball very high, 1-1. Tabler, last year, only seven times all year, batted with the bases loaded. And he made at least six pitches very miserable. He had six hits in those seven tries. Here's the 1-1 pitch. Foul back to the screen, 1-2. And I bring that up just because Tabler, whose career is rather unremarkable in most aspects, he's just been a good, solid player. In his career, has hit 6-11 with the bases loaded. And nobody in the last 11 years has even come close to that. The 1-2 pitch. Hit high and foul off the first base side. And there's the first souvenir of the day into the seats on the right field side of the field. One ball, two strikes. Tony Bernazard and Mel Hall will follow Tabler here in the second. The outfield fanned out straight away. The infield backed up. Here it comes. Screwball hit right back to Flanagan. He backhands the ball. Throws him out at first. Flanagan came off the mound to the third base side. Quickly reacting to that one, reached out to backhand it. And he got his man. And here is Tony Bernazard. Flanagan and all of the Oriole pitchers commenting just on how much work they did this spring. And even Earl Weaver said he'd worked the pitches so hard in spring training, so it'd be a shame if good things didn't come of it during the regular year. Flanagan said they never worked as hard in his memory in any spring in fundamental aspects of the game, such as fielding their position. Second inning, 1-0, Cleveland. Here's the pitch. And a let up is low for a ball, 1-1. Two men are out in the on-deck circle. Mel Hall and the rookie catcher, Andy Allenson. Of course, that is supposed to be against league rules. But this is Allenson's first day in the league, so you might not know those rules yet. 1-1 pitch, and it's low ball two. 2-1 the count. Bernazard hit .274 last year. Hit 11 home runs. The most home runs by an Indian second baseman in 21 years. 2-1 delivery. Slider missing inside. Ball three. Again, Flanagan thought he should have had that. Call the count, 3-1. Bernazard with a look at Gorrell, the third base coach. President Reagan, Commissioner of Baseball, Peter Urbaroff, Edward Bennett-Williams, all still sitting in the Oriole dugout. Pitch outside, ball four. So Bernazard draws a walk. Second walk allowed by Flanagan. One out, one on, and here is Mel Hall.
Batting eight, the left fielder, number 27, Mel Hall.
Hall, 25 years old, out of New York, was hitting .318 last year. When on May the 9th in Texas, he was involved in a freak car accident. And he was out the rest of the season. Left-hand swinger. Flanagan throws to first, and Bernazard is back. Hall was not going to be in there today, but Carmen Castillo, during batting practice, who was penciled into the lineup, hurt himself. He hit about six straight balls out of the ballpark, and then he took a mighty cut and pulled a muscle in his calf. Now the pitch to Hall. A slow curve, and it misses. Ball one, and Flanagan is right now wondering where Brinkman's strike zone is. I'm not saying from here that Brinkman is missing these calls. I'm merely stating that Flanagan seems to be a bit ruffled. One ball, no strikes. Hall with a wide-open stance. Flanagan throws over to first. Bernazard is back. One out, one on in the second. And the pitch. Fastball fouled into the batter's box. It hit Hall in the right ankle. 1-1. Hall, in that accident, suffered a fractured left clavicle, a fractured right side of the pelvic bone, a slight concussion, and a slight neck strain. And all things considered, was happy to still be breathing after it was all over with. Before he had the accident, he had a four-hit game against the Orioles last April, the most hits he's ever had in a game. The 1-1 pitch to him. Sidearm fastball hit deep into right center field.
Lynn and Lacey chasing it. This one is way back there, and it's off the wall at the 387 side. Around third is Bernazard. He's coming in to score. And to second with a double is Mel Hall, the man who wasn't supposed to play. Cleveland leads 2-0. Flanny dropped down from the side with a fastball, and Hall was not fooled whatsoever. And he hammered it at the base of the padded fence out there at the 387 side. 2-0 Cleveland. And now with his first major league at bat, here is catcher Andy Allinson. 24 years old from Richmond, Virginia. Right-hand batter, great big fella, 6'5". The pitch to him, a fastball, strike in the outside. Attended the University of Richmond, was an All-America there. Hit .312 in double-A ball last year, but he has never hit a home run at any level during his professional career. Bullpen activity again for the Orioles. Pitch is lined over Ripken's head and into left center field for a base hit. Hall holds up, but now he's being waved home. Shelby bobbled the ball. He hesitated, now throws home, and it's too late. Hall comes in to score, and the Indians lead 3-0. A single for Allinson and an error charged on Shelby for allowing Hall to score. Shelby charged that ball and tried to barehand it to make a play at home, but Hall had held up thinking that Ripken might catch the line drive, and he was going to stop at third. So then Shelby picked up the ball. Hall had stopped, but then Goro said, go ahead. But Shelby hesitated even after he picked up the ball, waiting to see what Hall was going to do, which the Orioles always teach, no, get rid of that ball right away. Bordy throwing in the Oriole bullpen, and Elrod Hendricks with a towel signaling that he is ready. And Kenny Rowe, the Orioles pitching coach, is out to the mound. The Indians are ahead 3-0 here in the second. As we go to the top of the batting order for Brent Butler. So Andy Allinson, in his first major league at bat, gets a base hit. And although he does not get an RBI, nonetheless, he's got to have a very big smile on his face right now. Allinson stole 22 bases last year, so even though he's a catcher and a big fella, you got to keep an eye on him. Here's Butler. Ground ball right along the third baseline. Foul. Chased by Gutierrez, but it was foul. 0-1 the count. Flanagan has issued a walk in each of the first two innings, and each time that walk has turned into a run. Murray on the bag at first with Allinson. Gutierrez in the grass at third. Butler crowding the plate, but in a wide open stance. Now Flanagan tosses over to first. Only one out, two runs in. And the big crowd very quiet right now. That wind is really picked up, blowing in from left and across to right. Again, a move to first by Flanagan. Allinson back. Joe Carter on deck. Ripken and Wiggins at short and second, pulled in a few steps. The pitch, bunted out in front of the plate. Dempsey chases out after it. Now Flanagan comes off the mound to get it. Throws to first just in time. Almost too late. So Allinson moves over. We'll see if they give Butler a sacrifice in that. They're not going to. Play goes from 1-3. It is the official scorer's discretionary capabilities there that determines that call. He's got to look inside the hitter's mind and decide whether he wanted to sacrifice or whether he was bunting for the hit. They figured he was bunting for the hit. Here's Carter, right-hand batter, takes a strike on the outside. Carter doubled along the left field line his first time. He's 1-for-1. Bordy still throwing in the bullpen, a right-hander. Runner at second, two out. Here's the pitch. Screwball line to Wiggins at second. He grabs it just off the shoe tops, and the side is retired. Two runs, two hits, one error, and after 1.5, Cleveland 3, the Orioles nothing. Fans, the scoreboard this year is brought to you courtesy of Gwaltney, where famous Gwaltney bacon and sausage have been making breakfast better since 1870. For great bargains on Gwaltney bacon or sausage, stop by the grand opening celebration of the new Klein's Super Thrift at the Beardshill Shopping Plaza in Aberdeen. If you're in the Washington area, you can pick up the telephone right now and order your seats for upcoming games on the schedule. For instance, the second opener here Wednesday in the Washington area, the number to call is 432-0200. That's in the 202 area code. 432-0200. Tell them what game, they'll give you the best seats available. And it's all done for you. If you order at least a week in advance, they'll pop the tickets in the mail and send them right to your home. That's Orioles phone charge. Last of the second, Freddie Lynn leads off. The Orioles behind 3-0. Here's Ken Schramm to Freddie Lynn. The pitch is a high pop fly to center field. Waiting for it, Brett Butler. Now back a few steps, and he makes the catch. And Lynn is out number one. That ball got out there pretty well. Lynn with a very easy looping swing at it, and the ball bringing Butler back near the warning track. One down, and here is Mike Young. In Detroit, Jim Rice has hit a home run in the third inning. Bases empty, and the Red Sox on homers by Evans and Rice, leading the Tigers 2-0. I don't believe either one of those fellas hit a home run in spring training. Mike Young batting left-handed. Schramm delivers, fastball missing inside. Young with 28 homers and 81 RBIs a year ago, and 22 of those homers after the All-Star break, second half of the year. The pitch, sinker is low, ball two. National League, the Gwaltney scoreboard. The Reds got four runs in the second inning against Steve Carlton. Eric Davis, a three-run homer in that rally. And since he is now ahead of Philly, 4-3 at the end of two. Later, San Diego at Los Angeles. Eric Schau and Fernando Valenzuela. 2-0 to Mike Young, the pitch. Ground ball to second. To his left is Bernazard out in shallow right field. He's got it. Throws him out. Quickly, 2 minutes gone in the Orioles' second, and here is John Shelby. Shelby in the lineup,
number 37,
rather than Larry Sheets or
Shelby.
Jim Dwyer, because he was just so very hot the last 10 days or so of spring training. In fact, he had 10 hits in his last 14 at-bats in Florida. So, Earl want to go with the hot hand. Shelby, 2-for-3. With two RBIs in his career against Schramm, which is also not too bad. Switch hitter batting left-handed. The pitch to him. And it's in there for a called strike. 0-1 the count. Later in the American League today, Milwaukee and Chicago. In fact, later is now. That game has started in Chicago. Milwaukee did not score in the first inning. Higuera versus Tom Seaver. The pitch. Turns a fastball over, misses outside with it, ball one. Indians with a run in the first and two more in the second to lead 3-0 as we play the last of the second. Two out, bases empty. Schramm into the windup. He throws. There's a liner into right center field for a base hit. Brett Butler hustling over to pick it up. Shelby takes the big turn and will hold it first. Butler got to the ball, and on the wet going out there, he slipped and started to fall for a moment. He regained his balance, and Shelby made the wise move in holding with a single. And here's Rick Dempsey.
Number 24, Rick Dempsey.
Dempsey had a heck of a spring. He had 319. He went on a serious training program this winter. Got himself a weight training coach. Looks like Arnold Schwarzenegger now. Except Rick's already married, and Arnold's going to be marrying Maria Shriver. Otherwise, he looks just like him. As they move over to first, and Shelby is back. Dempsey 36 years old now, but he had his best year last year with homers and RBIs. And he was off to a great start a year ago. Right-hand batter, Schramm, with Shelby leading from first. There goes Shelby. Pitch is hammered on one hop to shortstop. Franco, plenty of time, throws over to first for the out. The side is retired. One hit, one left. At the end of two, Cleveland three, the Orioles nothing. Mike Flanagan going through a shaky first two innings, trailing 3-0 as he faces Julio Franco here in the third. Throws one high and away for ball one. Franco, Thornton, and Jacoby, the 3, 4, and 5 hitters in the Cleveland batting order. Franco grounded slowly to third his first time. This time he drills it sharply to third and right by Gutierrez and into the left field corner. Hits off the wall, a carom played by Shelby. He throws in towards second, but Franco slides in there safely with a double. Boy, he shot that one. And certainly at third base, ball gets there a little bit quicker than it does at shortstop, where Gutierrez has played throughout his career. And Jackie seemed to be shocked that that one was there as quickly as it was. Rich Borde gets up again in the Oriole bullpen. Big right-hander. Here's Andre Thornton. Thornton hit into a fielder's choice, getting an RBI his first time. He's 0 for 1. Curve in the dirt for ball one. One ball and no strikes. Wednesday at 4:05 in the second opener, Mike Boddicker will go for the Orioles against Neil Heaton. Thursday night, Free Buck night, Ken Dixon versus Tom Candiotti. Pick up by second with Wiggins covering, and Franco dives back head first and was just there in time. 1-0 the count to Thornton. Flanagan with two starts against the Indians a year ago, went 5 1/3 innings each time. And one win and one no decision. Pitch is dribbled foul along the third base. Down one ball, one strike. He beat Brian 14. 8-6 in his career against them. And 6-2 in this ballpark against the Indians. And today, Mike Flanagan reaching a career milestone of sorts. This is his 300th big league game. Down to pitch. That's low for a ball. 2-1 to Thornton. One of only 300 games or more in an Orioles uniform. He's the fourth winningest pitcher in Orioles history. Franco away from second, nobody out. Flanagan looks at second, now steps off the rubber. Borde heating up in the bullpen. Three runs and four hits for the Indians now. Here's the pitch. Fastball missing outside, ball three. Now with a right-hand batter, Jacoby, coming up, Flanagan might be trying to work around Thornton here. If Thornton goes to first with a walk, that sets up a double play possibility. Would also mean he wouldn't have to face them both. Pickoff play at second again with Wiggins covering very close. But Franco's back. Second base umpire, Steve Palermo right there. Three and one to Thornton. The pitch. Swing and a foul tip right into Dempsey's glove. 3-2. Memorial Stadium, 309 feet to the foul lines. 360 feet. More straightaway left and right. 376 out into left and right center. 387 to very deep left and right center. And 405 to straightaway center. Flanagan looking back at Franco. Wiggins right near the bag. Now the 3-2 pitch. In the dirt with a curve. Dempsey blocks it. But Thornton has drawn the walk, and here comes Earl Weaver. Third walk by Flanagan. And Earl, before he even gets to the third base line, has already signaled for Rich Borde. So, we've got our first pitching change of the year, and unfortunately for Flanagan, it comes in the third inning. with nobody out. An early shower for the veteran lefty. Cleveland 3, the Orioles nothing. And while Borty comes on, we'll pause for these words.
John Miller and Tom Marr with you back at the stadium. 3-0 Cleveland. Rich Borty has come on in relief of Mike Flanagan with nobody out and two runners on, and the dangerous Brook Jacoby at the plate. Jacoby, a right-hand power hitter. Hit into a force out his first time. Franco, who has good speed, the runner at second. Thornton, who doesn't run that well, is at first. Third baseman Gutierrez, even with a bag, but wide at third. The pitch to Jacoby. Curve is low, ball one. Flanagan, two innings plus, allowing three runs and four hits. He walked three, and the base runners belong to him. Rich Borty with the Yankees last year, used mostly as a relief pitcher. Great big fella. 6 feet, 7 inches tall. Wearing uniform number 42 with the Orioles. The pitch. Swing and a miss. Strike one. One ball and one strike. Borty. He's been with some very successful clubs the last couple of years. He was with the Cubs in 84. 5-2 with four saves. Made seven starts there for Jim Pryor. Mostly used as a reliever. And for the first one, a divisional title. And with the Yankees last year, 51 appearances, three starts, including one here against the Orioles. With 6-8 with two saves. 3.21 earned. 1-1 the count. The pitch. Curve in the dirt. Dempsey blocks it. The ball rolls out in front of home plate under the infield grass. Dempsey chases it. Flips it back to Borty. 2-1 the count. Borty from San Francisco originally. Ripken and Wiggins both pinching toward the middle of the diamond. The outfield straight away for Jacoby. Chandler on deck. The pitch. Strike, a sinking fastball in at the knees. 2-2 the count. Right now, Borty's job is to keep the Indians from busting this one wide open. 3-0 is manageable. Gives the Orioles a lot of time to play catch-up. But 5 or 6-0, that's a whole different story. 2-2 pitch. Curveball looped over the head of Gutierrez, and into left field, base hit. Franco around third, he comes in to score. Shelby throws in towards third, a wild throw. Ripken had to go into the coach's box over there to grab it. Thornton to second and holding. And Jacoby, who hit it right off the end of the bat, a looping single in the left to make it 4-0 Cleveland. And here's Pat Tabler. Before he bats, we'll pause for station identification on the Orioles Radio Network.
Orioles Magic, back in...
WASA AM and WHDG FM, Hammond to Grace, Maryland, your sports authority.
Still nobody out of it.
And here is Pat Tabler. 4-0 Cleveland. That last run charged to Flanagan's record. And here's Tabler, who hit 346 with men in scoring position last year. Curve way outside, ball one. The Oriole bullpen with some stirring going on out there, but
3 years old.
Storm Davis.
Friday in Texas. And it is Storm back there.
Right-hander. The 1-0 pitch. There's a high, high pop fly along the right field line. Murray and Wiggins chasing out. Lacey comes racing in. And Lacey in foul territory makes the catch. Throws into Ripken in the middle of the diamond. The runners will hold. What a long run by Lacey. And he finally called off Murray and Wiggins and caught the ball right near the seats out there where the stands start to move out toward the foul line. Beautiful play by Lee Lacey, and Tabler is retired. Finally, there's one out of the inning, and here is Tony Bernazard. Switch-hitting second baseman. He walked in the second. Now he'll bat left-handed here in the third. Bernazard hit 274 a year ago. Bernazard from Puerto Rico. Indians picked him up in the deal that sent Jack Percotti and Gorman Thomas out to Seattle. Gutierrez, even with the grass at third, the pitch. Curve in the dirt. Ball went inside, ball one. Mel Hall is on deck. Thornton at second, Jacoby at first. 4-0 Indians, the pitch. Curve that misses, breaking a little bit low apparently. Two balls, no strikes. Lynn in center field, deep and over into right center. Lacey straight away in right. Left field is Shelby, not so deep, and over toward left center. Bernazard has some pop, as evidenced by his 11 home runs a year ago. Changeup is waved at and missed for a strike. Go on. Bernazard now strolls around in the batter's box, kicks at some dirt out in front of the box, and digs his left foot in again. He's wide open stance, crowding the plate, and deep in the box. Not a very big fellow. Holds the bat high, the pitch. Sinker is low, and it is 3-1. The Indians got a run in the first, then two more in the second, another here in the third so far. Bordy's never gotten Bernazard out. Bernazard 2-for-2 against him last year. The only times he's ever faced him. Bordy set. The runners go. The pitch is low and inside. Ball four, and the bases are loaded. That is the fourth walk by Oriole pitching. Here is Mel Hall. Hall drilled one off the fence in very deep right center to drive in the Indians' second run. Thornton at third, Jacoby at second. Bernazard at first. The Orioles looking for the double play ball. Pitch to Hall. Slow curve is low and inside, ball one. Bordy is a control type pitcher, and right now he's not getting his curve ball over, and here comes Ken Rowe, the Orioles pitching coach, out to talk with him. He'll be joined by Dempsey out there. The Indians right now on the verge of busting it wide open, already ahead by four in the third inning with the bases loaded. Last year in 98 innings, Bordy walked only 29. And the year before that in 83 innings in Chicago, he walked only 20. So he usually throws strikes. 1-0 the count. Goes back to the dugout. Thornton, Jacoby, and Bernazard with their leads. The pitch is swung on and missed. One ball, one strike. Allenson, the young catcher, is on deck.
Dr. Michael Stanford and Dr. Richard Schlesinger, please report to the Orioles office at once.
The outfield deep toward right against Hall. Mel really is down into a crouch. Now he asks for time and backs away. Bordy working from the stretch. Big right-hander set. The 1-1 pitch. Sinker is low. 2-1 the count. Boston leading Detroit 2-1 at the end of four now. Milwaukee, Chicago, 1-1 after two. Rob Deere, a home run against Seaver in that game for Milwaukee. Here it's 4-0 Cleveland. In the third, the pitch, liner to center. Lynn starts in, now backs up, jumps up and makes the catch. It almost sailed right over his head. Thornton tags and scores. The other runners hold, and the Indians now lead 5-0. Hall really drilled that one. Solid liner to center, and ball apparently had the backspin on it. It'd be tough for an outfielder to pick that up. Usually when a ball's hit that way, You figure he's over the top of it a little bit, it's going to start to fade, but that one just kept sailing with the backspin. But Lynn was able to make the catch on it. Sacrifice fly, the second RBI for Hall. Two out and two on. Here's Andy Allenson. Looks at a curve for a called strike one. 0-1. Allenson in his first big league at bat. Single to left field in the second inning. Brett Butler is on deck. The pitch. Curve outside for a ball. 1-1. Storm Davis still throwing in the bullpen. Cincinnati 5, Philadelphia 4 after 3.5. Schmidt with a home run for the Phillies. Carlton and Soto working there. All five of these runs charged to Mike Flanagan. The runners out there now belong to Bordy. The pitch, little tapper by the mound towards short. Ripken charges, gloves it, the off-balance throw, not in time. And there we see Allenson's speed. He beat it easily. Little tapper right by the third base side of the mound, and Bordy came off to the first base side, had no chance to get it. Ripken made a heck of a play on it. An off balance across the body throw. And nonetheless, he couldn't get it. And now they're loaded for Brett Butler. Six hits for the Indians now. Butler has walked and was thrown out trying to bunt his way aboard in the second. He's 0 for 1. Base is loaded again. Two runs in, the Indians ahead, 5-0. Here's Bordy from the stretch. Fastball for a called strike in the inside corner. In his 2 years with Cleveland, Brett Butler, when he has batted with the bases loaded, has hit .393. The one strike delivery. Change up. Bloop back a third. Out goes Gutierrez. In comes Shelby. And the ball drops untouched right between them on the warning track near the seats over there. Ball just not hit high enough in the air for anybody to get to it. The count is 0-2. Joe Carter is on deck. Jacoby, the runner at third. Bernazard is the runner at second. And Allenson, the runner at first. The outfield bunched up toward left. Shelby, shallow and left. The infield backed up all the way around, except third baseman Gutierrez, who's even with the bag. The two-strike pitch on the way. Curve is low. 1-2. Some of the lights have been turned on here at the stadium. The ones that are directed toward the infield. Some heavy cloudiness has started to come into the area now, so it's grown darker. The 1-2 pitch, curve high, ball two. 2-2. Well, Cleveland's been jumping all over the Orioles. The Orioles have been very quiet against Ken Schramm so far. Again, Bordy to the plate. Very high, ball three. Bordy's control just hasn't been there. They'll all be going now. Jacoby, Bernazard, and Allenson will take off with this pitch. 3-2 at two down in the third inning. 5-0 Cleveland. The stretch, the runners go. The pitch, grounded foul, first base side. Runners will go back now. Butler hard to strike out. Struck out about once every 14 and a half times last year. And he also usually gets a lot of walks. Again, Bordy nods his head to Dempsey's side. The runners move. The pitch. A fly ball to center field. Lynn coming in and to his left. He's under it. And he has it. And at long last, the inning is over. Eight men bat. Two of them scored. Three of them stranded. And after 2.5, the Orioles are trailing Cleveland 5-0. Outside of the Baltimore and Washington areas, who'd like to take advantage of the services of Phone Charge to order your tickets to Orioles games this year, well, There's an 800 number for you. Dial 1-800-448-9009. That's 1-800-448-9009. And if you call and order your tickets at least 7 days in advance of the game you want to see, well, they'll put the tickets in the mail and send them right to you. It's the fast, easy way to get your tickets to Orioles baseball 1986.
The third baseman, number 11.
Right now it's time for K. Jewelers time. 316, thereabouts. 1986 marks K. Jewelers' 70th year of service to the Baltimore, Washington area. With over 275 stores nationally, K. Jewelers, the Diamond People, featuring the Wittenauer watch. In honor of K. Jewelers' 70th anniversary, I've changed my middle name to Wittenauer. This is John Wittenauer Miller, the fourth. The pitch to Jackie Gutierrez, a changeup from Ken Schramm, and it's in there for a strike. 0-1 the count. Gutierrez hitting ninth in the order. Be followed by Wiggins and Lacey. 5-0, Cleveland. Pitch inside for a ball, 1-1. Gutierrez played as a regular 2 years ago in Boston and hit .263. Suffered an injury early last year and lost his job to Glenn Hoffman. And really suffered at the plate as a result and hit only .218. Right-hand batter. The 1-1 pitch. Curve outside for a ball, 2-1. Gutierrez, quite an athlete, and an all-round athlete at that. In his native Colombia, he, as a youth, participated in the decathlon, the national youth track meet. Pitch popped foul, coming back into the upper deck above us, and the count now is 2-2. And he comes from quite an athletic family. His father, Campo Gutierrez, competed in the 1936 Olympics in Berlin, and his brother Freddie competed in the 1964 Olympic Games in Tokyo for Colombia. Here's the 2-2 pitch on the way. There's a ground ball into the hole at short. To his right is Franco. He one-hands it, throws to first for the out. Corrales has worked with Franco ever since Corrales got to Cleveland, and not doing that, but Franco likes doing it.
Second baseman, Allen.
So he keeps Wiggins doing it. He ranged over, got right in front of the ball, and instead of just picking the ball up like you see Ripken do or any other shortstop, two-handed, he gets right in front of it and then scoops it up one-handed. Sometimes he doesn't scoop it up. That's why he made 36 errors last year. Here's Allen Wiggins, one out. Well, he scooped that one up nicely enough. Wiggins flying to left his first time. He's batting left-handed. Takes a strike from Ken Schramm, and it's 0-1. 5 runs, 6 hits for the Indians. The Orioles, no runs, 2 hits. The outfield over toward the left field line. Jacoby shallow at third. Sinker ball misses. 1-1. Schramm was the starting pitcher for Minnesota last year in a very memorable ball game at the stadium. He pitched extremely well and left ahead 2-1 and said his shoulder tightened up. There's a looping liner into left center field, base hit. Brett Butler over to pick it up, so Wiggins gets a single for the one out, and Lee Lacey coming up. You know what happened. It was the night after Freddie Lynn had hit a home run against Ron Davis to win a ball game in the ninth inning. Schramm left the game the next night, and against the Twins bullpen, Lynn hit another home run to win a ball game. Billy Gardner was not too excited that Schramm left that game. And eventually, the Twins said so long to Ken Schramm. Well, that's a new year with a new ball club, and right now he's got a 5-run lead in the third inning. Life is good. Wiggins away from first. Schramm holds at the belt. Now the pitch to Lacey. Missing inside with a breaking ball. Lacey, single to left his first time. The wind has shifted and is blowing out toward left field now. Earlier it was coming in from left. Throw to first, and Wiggins dives back. It was a lob throw, ended up almost in the dirt. Tambler had to pick it off the shoe tops over there. 1-0 to Lacey. Ripken is on deck. Hey. Big crowd, ready to explode, hoping to have something to cheer about. The pitch. There's a called strike on the outside. A slider in there. One ball, one strike. The Orioles had one game here last year against the Indians where they made a huge comeback in the eighth inning of a game against Bert Blyleven to post a victory. There's a bluff over to first. Wiggins goes back. 1-1 to Lacy. They're going to need a long comeback today, trailing 5-0 here in the third. One out and one on. And a move to first by Schramm. Wiggins is back. Again the stretch. And the pitch to Lee Lacy. Bouncer to short, could be two. Fielded by Franco to second for one. Bernazard to first. Double play. 6-4-3, and the inning is over. One hit, nobody left, and a third of the way through it. It's Cleveland 5, the Orioles nothing. All right, Tom.
Thanks, John. Carter leads it off. He's 1-for-2. The pitch to him, swing and a miss, and a breaking ball. Carter doubled in the first inning, then lined out to the second baseman, Alan Wiggins, his next time up. It's all Indians thus far. The crowd is quiet and impatient. 5-0, the Tribe leading it. The next pitch from Bordy is low. Mike Flanagan worked the first two innings plus, and he has been charged with all five runs. Bordy's 1-1 is on the way. Swing and a miss. One ball and two strikes. On the Gwaltney scoreboard, bottom of the fifth inning, and the Red Sox leading the Tigers 2-1 with the Tigers at bat. Here's the 1-2 delivery, swing and a miss. He struck him out. Carter goes down on strikes. That's the first for Bordy. And that'll bring up Julio Franco. The Red Sox runs coming on home runs from Evans and Rice. Hurst working for the Red Sox. Jack Morris for the Tigers. Milwaukee and Chicago tied up 1-1, bottom of the third in Chicago. Teddy Higuera against Tom Seaver for the White Sox. Franco takes the first pitch. It's in there for a call strike. On the Gwaltney scoreboard in the National League, the Reds leading the Phillies 5-4 in the bottom of the fifth. Morty's one strike pitch is on the way. A chopping ground ball toward short. Ripken charging in, makes the pickup. The good, strong throw to first. And Franco is retired. Two up and two down. First time the Orioles have been able to retire the first two men in the Cleveland half of an inning. Andre Thunder Thornton is up. Thornton reached on a fielder's choice in the first inning and got credit for an RBI. He walked and scored in the third inning. Bordy's pitch is on the way to Thornton, and it's in there for a call strike. This is the best time to face Andre Thornton with two outs and nobody on. Brooke Jacoby is on deck for the Tribe. Here comes the pitch from Rich Bordy. Swing and a miss. Two strikes. The off-speed breaking ball. Thornton was thinking fastball, and he was way out in front on that one. Bordy has struggled since coming in for Flanagan, but he appears to have settled out in this inning. Two strikes the count to Thornton with two outs and nobody on. Here's the pitch, and it's low. The Orioles won the season series against the Tribe last year, 8-5. Bordy kicks and deals the 1-2, and it's lined on one hop to Gutierrez. What a pickup at third. The throw to first in time. A gem of a play by Gutierrez at third. A rocket hit his way. And he had to play an extremely tough hop. He did so, and an excellent throw to first base. A very strong arm. Thornton is out. Fine play by Jackie. Three up, three down. At the end of 3.5, the score continues. The Indians 5 and the Orioles nothing. We are back at Memorial Stadium in Baltimore. bottom of the fourth inning, and the Orioles are looking to get something going against Ken Schramm. Five runs and six hits for the Indians. The Orioles, no runs and three base hits. And the Orioles got the big guns coming up in this inning. Ripken, Murray, and Lynn, and possibly more. Ken Schramm standing erect, getting the sign from the rookie catcher, Allinson, down the hill with his first pitch, and he comes inside. An off day for both teams tomorrow, then the second opener on Wednesday afternoon at 4:05. Plenty of seats available, and we hope to see you here at the ballpark. Game time again, 4:05. One ball and no strikes, the count to Ripken. Ripken was out on a fly ball to the center fielder, Brett Butler, his first time up. It's just a delightful afternoon for baseball at Memorial Stadium. Game time temperature was 68 degrees. Here's the pitch to Rip. It comes inside 2-0. Schramm on the hill. Allinson is behind the plate. Pat Tabler's at first. Tony Bernazard at second. Franco the shortstop, and Brooke Jacoby is at third. Into the outfield, Hall and left. The center fielder Butler and Joe Carter is in right. The outfield shaded around to left for Ripken. Schramm is into his wide. Here's the pitch to Cal. Ball three. Three balls and no strikes. Schramm is an off-speed pitcher. He won't overpower you. Throws a fastball, a curveball, changes speeds effectively. Also throws a slider. Three balls and no strikes, the count to Ripken. Schramm works again, and here's the pitch. And it's a call strike on the inside. Ripken awaiting the 3-1. Schramm nods in approval to the sign from Allinson. He's into his wind, and here's the pitch. And it's tapped out in front of home plate, picked up by Allinson. The throw to first in time. Ripken topped it right into the area of home plate, a fair ball, and Allinson pounced out from behind the plate to make the pickup and the throw to first. So Rip is out with the play going 2-3. The Orioles enjoyed their biggest come-from-behind victory against the Indians here last April. It was on the 28th. The Indians jumped on Storm Davis in that game for six runs in the second inning, and they led 7-1 through 3.5. Eddie Murray is the batter. Murray grounded out his first time up. Here's the pitch to Eddie, and he hits a pop fly out into very shallow left field. Left fielder on. The shortstop is out, Franco, and he makes the one-handed grab. Hall came charging in. Two up and two down. The Orioles trailing 7-5 in that game. They rallied for three to win it in the eighth inning. Eddie Murray tied that game with a two-out double, and then John Lowenstein, playing his next-to-last game, drove in his last game-winning RBI. The batter is Fred Lynn. Lynn was out on a drive to center field his first time out. This is Tom Marr along with John Miller bringing you Oriole baseball. Schramm shakes off Allinson. Lynn, a left-handed batter. Two outs and nobody on. A curveball drops in low. Mike Young is in the on-deck circle should Lynn keep the Orioles going here in the fourth. Here's the pitch to Lynn, a ground ball, bounce foul off the first base side. The Tigers have scored three runs in the fifth inning. They lead Boston 4-2. Sammy Stewart has come on for Bruce Hurst. Looking at the Gwaltney scoreboard, Kirk Gibson with a home run in that game, his first of the year, a two-run homer, of course his first of the year. 1-1, the count to Lynn. Here is the pitch to Fred. He hits a drive into right center field. Could fall in for a base hit, and does. Butler cuts it off, and Lynn will be held to a single. Fred Lynn with his first hit of the 1986 season. And that'll bring up Mighty Mike Young. Milwaukee and Chicago tied 1-1 at the end of three. Deer and Riles Ryles has now homered in the fourth with a bat aboard, so Milwaukee leads that game 3-1. Teddy Higuera for Milwaukee, Tom Seaver. Tom, terrific, pitching for the White Sox. Mike Young grounded out to second his first time up. Fred Lynn with a lead at first base. T-Bone Shelby is on deck. Schraub working from the stretch. Here's the pitch to Young, and it's a ball. National League, the Reds lead the Phillies in Cincinnati 7-4 at the end of five. Carlton started. Anderson now on for the Phillies. Mario Soto pitching for the Reds in that one. Lynn is off at first. Tabler holding with a runner. Young, a switch hitter, batting left-handed against Schraub. 1-0 is on the way, and it's a call strike, a breaking ball. Mike Young, the designated hitter today. T-Bone Shelby had a very hot bat in the latter part of spring training, so that earned him a start today in left field. T-Bone in the on-deck circle. Here comes the pitch to Young. A ground ball, foul off the first baseline. The Indians with a run in the first, two in the second, and two in the third. The Orioles have yet to break through against Ken Schraub. Mike Young is out of the batter's box. Now Young steps back in. Lynn with a lead at first base. Schraub will look that way. The 1-2 pitch, and it's low. Two balls and two strikes. Mike Young has 7 home runs and 18 RBIs and 18 career games against the Indians. Here's the 2-2 to Young. Ball three low. Three balls and two strikes. Three and two. The count to Mike Young with Fred Lynn at first base. 5-0. The Tribe leads it. The outfield is around the right. Most of the field now in sunshine on this partly cloudy day. The skies have been filled with clouds and helicopters. Also, a big blimp has been in the area. Here's a 3-2 to Young, and he gets around with it and strikes out. Mike Young goes down on strikes to end the inning. So for the Orioles in their half of the fourth, no runs, a hit, a runner is left. Rich Forty on the mound in relief of Mike Flanagan. And the fans are getting restless. Here's the pitch to Jacoby. And it's high, one ball and no strikes. The next pitch to Jacoby is foul back our way. Jacoby in this game is 1-for-2. He has singled and knocked in a run.
Plane just went by with one of those messages behind it. It said, cheer if you love Memorial Stadium.
Well, that's the reason for the outbreak of cheering. Here comes the 1-1 to Jacoby, and it's lined into left field for a base hit. So Jacoby with his second hit, and that will set the stage for Pat Tabler. Tabler is 0-for-2. Our scoreboard this year brought to you by the good people at Gwaltney, makers of world-famous Gwaltney Franks. All meat or all beef, your choice for great taste. And this week, you can save money on Gwaltney Franks at all Baltimore area Bain's Super Thrift stores. Tabler stands in against Rich Forty with a runner at first. The infield pulls to double play depth. The outfield is straight away for Pat Tabler. The on-deck batter is now Tony Bernazar. Here comes Forty's pitch. And it's in there for a call strike. The blimp we mentioned is the Fujifilm blimp. A big green and white one. And it's been circling Memorial Stadium most of the day. And here comes the plane with a trailer. Stand up and cheer if you love Memorial Stadium. Last time it went by, a lot of folks did that. One strike to count to Tabler. Here's the pitch, and a high pop fly is lifted to the left side in foul territory. Gutierrez moving into foul territory and makes the catch. So Tabler is retired. And the batter is going to be Tony Bernazard. Bernazard walked and scored in the second inning and walked his second time up. Runner at first. Here's the pitch to Bernazard, and it's bounced foul off the first base side. Bernazard, in his first year in the league with the Chicago White Sox, wore the Orioles out. He went 17 for 36. That's an average of .488. But since then, he's been a .195 hitter against them. The pitch to Tony swings and fouls one into the dirt. Two strikes to count to Bernazard. Bernazard is a switch hitter. He is batting left-handed against the right-handed pitching of Rich Borde. All is on deck. 5-0. The Indians lead it, trying to add more here in the top of the fifth inning. The outfield is around to right. Bernazard, figuring Borde is taking too much time, and he asked for time, and it's been granted by the home plate umpire, Joe Brinkman. Here's the pitch. It's outside. 1-2. Ripken shouting something over to Wiggins. Bernazard in an open stance, keeps the bat waving. Now he's ready, and here comes the pitch. The 1-2 curveball, he's called out on strikes. Good looking hook from Borde. Strikeout number 2 for Borde. Borde got the Indians 1-2-3 in the last inning. Jacoby led off this inning with a base hit. Since then, Tabler has fouled out, and Bernazard has gone down on strikes, and here is Mel Hall. Allinson makes his way into the on-deck circle. The pitch to Hall, and he hits one, just snubs one off the third base side. Borde over to pick it up, throws to first in time, and Hall is retired. The play goes 5-3. Nubbed one off the end of the bat on the third base side, and quickly Borde gets off the mound. Devon Shelby leads it off against Ken Schraub. We are in the bottom of the fifth inning. The Orioles, no runs and 4 hits. The Indians, 5 runs and 7 hits. T-Bone batting left-handed against the right-hander on the hill. Here comes the first pitch from Schramm. A fastball is grounded foul off the first base side. Shelby will be followed in this inning by Dempsey and Gutierrez. Gutierrez at third base today has made a couple of fine plays and has exhibited an extremely strong arm. One strike, the count to T-Bone. Here is the pitch, and it comes inside, 1-1. Shelby, as we mentioned at the top of our broadcast, with a hot bat in spring training, especially in the closing weeks after a slow start, and has one of the 4 Oriole hits in this game. Here's the pitch to T-Bone, and it comes in low, 2-1. This is Tom Marr along with John Miller at Memorial Stadium, the place to be for the 1986 season. The 2-1 to T-Bone. Danny fouls it back our way. An off day tomorrow. 4:05 start on Wednesday afternoon with a second opener. Then Thursday night, these two teams wind up the homestand, and it's going to be 3-buck night. 2-2, the count to Shelby. Here's the pitch to T-Bone, a ground ball right back to the mound. Schramm's got it, throws to first, and T-Bone is retired. The play goes 1-3. Buddy's night, when the Orioles meet the White Sox on May the 13th, is going to benefit the Baltimore Police Youth Clubs. Come out to the ballpark and see a great ball game and help support youth activities for more than 1,500 inner city children.
We have the attendance. I might preface that by saying that this is the largest.
Rick Dempsey stands in. We're getting an announcement now on the attendance. Here's the pitch to Dempsey. It comes inside, one ball and no strikes. 52,000 plus at Memorial Stadium. Here comes the 1-0, swing and a miss at a breaking ball. 52,292, and did they say that's the largest regular season crowd in the history of the franchise?
That's right.
It's a big one. One and one, the count to Dempsey. There's one out. Here's the pitch to Rick. Swing and a miss. Strike two to Dempsey. Dempsey grounded out in his first at bat. The police youth clubs we mentioned, they operate two recreation centers, a summer recreational activities program, and a summer camp. One out, nobody on. One and two, the count to Dempsey. Here's Schramm's pitch. And it's lined to left field. That will fall in for a base hit. The left fielder cuts it off, and Dempsey will be held to a single as Hall was over there to pick it up. So Dempsey is aboard at first with a single. We'll see if Gutierrez can get something going against Ken Schramm. By the way, when you help those kids and you can come out and see a great ball game on May the 13th, a reminder, the tickets are $5.50 and $6.50, and they can be purchased at any Baltimore City police station.
The largest regular season crowd in Orioles history before today was for opening day in 1982, which was April the 5th, and that was 336 fewer than I hear today.
Gutierrez crowded out his first time up. Schramm is working for the stretch. Here's the pitch, and he gets a call strike.
In the largest crowd in the history of the stadium, period, for a baseball game was for the opening game of the World Series with the Dodgers, October the 9th of 66, 54,458.
One strike, the count to Gutierrez. Dempsey's at first. Here's the pitch. A ground ball headed toward short. Could be two. It's by Franco, however. And it goes into center field, and everybody's going to be safe. Taylor made double play ball, hit right at Julio Franco, and it got by him. Dempsey is at second base, and Gutierrez reaches, and Franco will be charged with an error.
Well, it took a bad hop on Franco, but he tried to play it off to the side and one-handed again, and that's why Corrales is so down on that. Had he gotten in front of that ball, he would have gotten at least one out, even with a bad hop, because he would have been able to knock it down with a body.
So Franco feels badly about that one, but Schramm may feel a little worse. Franco last year committed 36 errors. And he has picked up his first of 1986 in this game. And here is Wiggins. He's one for two, runners at first and second. Here's the pitch to Wiggins. He bunts right out in front of the mound. Schramm will pick it up, the throw to first. And it's dropped by Tabler. Everybody's safe. Dempsey's headed home. And Dempsey is safe at home. Charges to third. 5-1.
Dempsey missed home plate
and came back.
Allenson was looking out to the bases to make sure that nobody else was trying to take an extra base. And Rick turned around and very quickly, with Allenson's back turned to the plate, he went back and stepped on it. And then, and only then, did Brinkman signal save.
There is no RBI. It looked like Wiggins was going to be out at first base, but Tabler dropped the ball. And Dempsey, he realized it. He got up and ran right back by home plate, as John mentioned. And that was at the point where Brinkman singled the safe side. So there are runners on the corners. It's a 5-1 game. Lacey is up. Schramm working from the stretch to throw to first. It's into the dirt, and Tabler makes a good stop. Schramm trying to work on the troublesome Wiggins at first base. That's what Wiggy can do at first. He can rattle the pitcher, and Schramm just threw one into the dirt. And it almost got by Tabler. Easterly and Knowles are now up and working in the Indians' bullpen. On the last play, Charge Tabler, the first baseman, with an error. Here's the pitch to Lacy, and it comes in low, gets away from Allenson, but he's able to keep it in the area of home plate. Wiggins is the runner at first base. Dempsey is home with the Orioles' first run, and Gutierrez is at third. Schramm to Lee Lacy. Wiggins goes. The throw to second. Wiggins slides, and the throw is out into right field. Gutierrez will score, and Wiggins goes to third, and it's a 5-2 game. Two balls and no strikes. Now the count to Lacy, and listen to the crowd.
Franco did not get over to the bag until late, and Allenson held up just a little bit before he made the throw. And thus, when Franco finally did get over there, Allenson didn't have much power behind the throw. And it looked like nobody had made the decision they were going to cover, or nobody saw that Wiggins was running one way or the other.
Give Wiggins credit for a stolen base and charge an error to Allenson. And now, Pat Corrales is coming out to talk to his pitcher and the catcher, Allenson. Bernazard comes over. Wiggins, 5-2 game, and Wiggins is now at third base. Allen Wiggins, just as we were telling you, has the ability, because of his speed on the bases, to rattle the pitcher. And in that case, rattle the catcher as well, and the middle of the infield. Lacy is 1-2. Wiggins at third. Here's the pitch to Lacy, and he hits a high pop-up to the right side. Tabler calling for it, as is Bernazard. Bernazard waving off Tabler and makes the catch. Wiggins holding him third, of course, so Lacy is retired, popping up to Tony Bernazard, and now Cal Ripken Jr. with two outs and a runner at third base. Ripken this game is 0-2. Eddie Murray is on deck. Five runs, seven hits for the Indians, and three errors. Two runs, five hits for the Orioles, and they've committed one miscue. Wiggins is the runner at third for Ripken. Schramm trying to work out of some difficulty in this inning. Here's the pitch to Rip. Comes inside. One ball and no strikes.
Cal has 10 hits against Schramm in his career. Four doubles and three homers.
Schramm nods in approval to the sign from Allenson. Rip awaits the 1-0. Here is the pitch. And a high foul ball into the seats in the upper deck on the left side. 1-1, the count to Ripken. So the fans feel a lot better. It is still early in the game with the Orioles scoring two in this inning. Here's the pitch to Ripken. Call strike. Rip would like to see that pitch again. 1-2, the count to Ripken. Cal steps out of the batter's box. Schramm looking into Allenson. Says okay to the sign. Now he'll check Wiggins coming down the line at third. Here's the 1-2 to Rip. Inside, 2-2. Rip awaits the 2-2 with the runner at third. Here's the pitch, and it almost gets away from Allenson. Three balls and two strikes. So the count is full. The payoff pitch is next. Big moment in the game right now. The Indians are running the first, two in the second, and two in the third. The Orioles, two here in the bottom of the fifth. Three balls and two strikes. The count to Cal Ripken Jr. Schramm ready to work. He's at the belt from the stretch. Here's the pitch to Riff. Call strike three. Ripken is called out on strikes by home plate umpire Joe Brinkman. Andy Allenson leads it off against Rich Forte as we're in the sixth inning. The Indians lead it 5-2. This is Tom Marr along with John Miller. We hope to see you Wednesday afternoon when the Orioles meet the Indians. 4:05 game time for the second opener, and plenty of seats are available. Allenson in this game is 2-for-2. He bunts out in front of the mound. Borty's picks it up, throws to first just in time. A high throw. Eddie was able to reach up and pull it down. And Allenson displaying good speed again, but he's thrown out. The play goes 1-3. Allenson now 2-for-3. Both Oriole runs in the last inning were unearned against Ken Schramm. Brett Butler is the batter. Butler walked and scored in the first inning, has gone 0-for-2 since. Joe Carter moves into the on-deck circle. Butler, a left-handed hitter, but the Orioles play him to go to left field. The outfield is aligned as if a right-handed pull hitter was up. They're around to left. Here's the pitch to Butler, and he fouls one back. One strike to count to Brett. Kay Jewelers' time is 4:02. 1986 marks Kay Jewelers' 70th year of service to the Baltimore, Washington area. Kay Jewelers with over 275 stores nationally. Kay Jewelers, the Diamond People, featuring the Wittenauer watch. Here comes a one-strike pitch, and it's foul back. Two strikes, and Butler is in the hole to Rich Forte. Forte says okay to the sign from Dempsey. The two-strike delivery, and it's popped up behind home plate. Dempsey going back after it and makes the catch on the cinder track. Gutierrez also coming over on that one. Dempsey handles it, so two up and two down. And here's Joe Carter. Carter doubled in his first at bat. Since then, he has lined out and has gone down on strikes. 5-2, the Tribe leads it. We're in the sixth inning. Morty on the hill. Here's the wind and the pitch, and it is fouled off the mask of Dempsey. The Indians did some heavy sticking against the Orioles last year. Franco hit 396, Tabler 395, Jacoby 347. But the Orioles out-homered the Indians. The Orioles hit 26 against the Tribe. Here's the pitch. Swing and a miss. Carter chasing a bad pitch. The Indians hit just 9 home runs against the Orioles. The outfield is straight away for Carter. Here comes a two-strike delivery popped up in the area of home plate. Dempsey has an eye on it along the third baseline. Gutierrez now calling for it. Dempsey holds on, and Dempsey and Gutierrez collide. And hopefully Jackie's going to be all right. He's getting up slowly. And it looks like Gutierrez is all right. The two collide. Borty in that situation is supposed to be the traffic cop, but apparently if he was doing some police work out there, Gutierrez didn't hear him. So the side is retired. Three up, three down. At the end of 5.5, it's the Indians 5, the Orioles 2. Followed by Fred Lynn and Mike Young. The Orioles need 3 to tie it. Here's the pitch, and Eddie hits a high pop fly. Bernazard behind second, calling everybody off, and makes the catch. And Eddie skies out to Bernazard, and Murray is now 0-for-3. That'll bring up Fred Lynn. Lynn has one of the 5 Oriole hits. He singled his last time up. Schramm in his wide. Here's the pitch to Lynn. Swing and a miss. One strike to count to Fred. Now a paper plane comes flying down in front of Fred Lynn. Time is called. Allinson retrieves it and gives it to Joe Brinkman, and that's the end of that paper plane as it's just been crushed to death. One strike to count to Freddie Lynn. Schramm's pitch is on the way to Lynn, and a breaking ball drops in low. One ball and one strike. The outfield is around to right for Lynn. Schramm standing erect as he checks in to get the side, and the 1-1 is on the way. The pitch at a high pop fly, foul territory off the third base side. Jacoby calling for it, and he makes the catch. And Lynn is retired. Two outs in the inning. The Orioles with a lot of pop-ups in this game against Ken Schramm.
Designated hitter, Mike Young.
That'll bring up the designated hitter, Mike Young. Young is 0 for 2. He has grounded out and gone down on strikes. Young batting left-handed. The outfield is around to right. T-Bone Shelby is on deck. Schramm's ready. Kicks and fires a ground ball to Tabler at first. He's got it. He races to the bag ahead of Mike Young. And that's it for the Orioles. They go quietly in their half of the sixth inning. Three up, three down. The end of six from Memorial Stadium. Indians 5, the Orioles 2.
One for three in the ball game. He has grounded a third. He's doubled, and he has grounded a shortstop. One for three. Here's the pitch from Bordy, and a fastball for a strike. Bordy struggled when he first came in there. Gave up a couple of hits and a walk, and a couple of runs charged to Mike Flanagan's record. But since then, he's really settled down. Just missing outside with a fastball. One and one. Franco, Thornton, and Jacoby, the 3, 4, and 5 hitters in the Cleveland batting order. 5-2, the Indians out in front in the seventh. Here's Bordy's pitch. Ground ball hits slowly foul third base side. John Gorrell, third base coach, picks it up. He'll toss it out of play. 1-2 the count. The Indians with a run in the first, 2 in the second, and 2 in the third. The Orioles getting 2 in the fifth. Both gifts of the Indians. Slider outside for a ball, 2-2. And the Gwaltney scoreboard, wild one at Tiger Stadium. Tigers have lost the lead to the Red Sox, and now they have regained it. The pitch outside with a curve, 3-2. Red Sox got 3 runs in the seventh, a 2-run homer by Baylor and a solo homer by Gedman to go ahead 5-4. Here's the 3-2 pitch now to Franco. And he loops it foul off to the right into the crowd, 3-2. But then in the last of the seventh, against former Orioles Sammy Stewart, Kirk Gibson with his second home run of the game. A 2-run shot, putting Detroit back ahead, 6-5. That's at the end of 7 full now. And as far as we know, Jack Morris still in there for the Tigers, working the eighth inning, ahead 6-5. Even though he's given up 4 homers to the Red Sox. Curve outside, ball 4, so Franco draws a walk. Coming into this inning, Bordy had retired 10 of the last 11 hitters he'd faced. Here's Andre Thornton. That's the second walk by Bordy. He's worked 4 innings plus. And the 5th walk overall by Orioles pitching. The Orioles issued a lot of walks last year, and Earl Weaver wanted to cut down in that aspect of the game. And in the springtime, Oriole pitchers did cut down on the walks, but they've been there very much in evidence today. Throw to first, and Franco gets back. Thornton, the hitter, he has hit into a fielder's choice with a run scoring, an RBI. He's walked and scored a run, and drilled one that Gutierrez gobbled up at third in the fourth inning and threw him out. Great play by Gutierrez. Kerr swung on, bounced foul back behind the plate. The count is 0-1. Storm Davis has started throwing in the Oriole bullpen again, a right-hander. And now Brad Havens, a left-hander, has joined him. Boston has had home runs today from Evans, Rice, Baylor, and Gedman at Tiger Stadium. Gibson has hit 2 for Detroit. six home runs in the first seven innings of the first game of the year in Detroit. Throw to first, and Frank goes back. The Orioles, the last game they played in Detroit last year, there were nine home runs hit. The Orioles hit six of them. 0-1 the count to Thornton, the pitch. Curveball is popped up foul and out of play off to the right. Back into the lower deck, 0-2. Brewers, 3. Chicago, 2 at the end of 5. Couple of home runs allowed by Tom Seaver in that game. Rob Deere, home run hitter who strikes out a lot, acquired from the Giants, hit one. And Ernie Riles hit a two-run homer in the fourth inning from Milwaukee. Higuera versus Seaver in that game. Throw to first, and Franco is back. There have been three home runs hit in Cincinnati today. The Reds are leading the Phillies 7-4 at the end of 7. Schmidt has homered for the Phillies. Eric Davis and Dave Parker homered for the Reds. Franco is running. The ball is swung on and missed. Dempsey throws to second. Wiggins tags. Out at second. From 2-4, Thornton strikes out into a double play. Thornton strikes out, and the caught stealing from 2-4. Perfect throw by Rick. Two down and nobody on, and here is Brooke Jacoby. Jacoby is hit into a force out. He has singled home a run, and then he singled again in the fifth. His two hits coming against Bordy. 2-for-3 overall. Now the pitch, and a curve misses for ball one. Two down in the seventh. 5-2, Cleveland. Padres and the Dodgers just getting started out in L.A. Jacoby fouls one back, 1-1. Eric Schau versus Fernando Valenzuela. That's the Gwaltney scoreboard up till now. Brooke Jacoby, his father played some pro ball in a couple of different organizations. His father lives in the Baltimore area now. One pitch, swing and a foul. That one hits off Dempsey's mask. He takes the mask off, and he's now cursing the baseball that would have the audacity to do that to him. Nick walks away from the plate, shakes it off. Jacoby's father, Brooks Sr., played for both Cleveland and Philadelphia in his career in their minor league systems. Fastball, there's a high drive into left center field, deep. Lynn back to the warning track. He's back to the wall. Jumps up, and he makes the catch! Back near the Oriole bullpen, and Lynn went back on it ever so easily, and right at the wall, he leaped up and brought it right back into the ballpark. Seventh inning stretch time at the stadium. Cleveland 5, the Orioles 2. Here come the Orioles. Last of the seventh inning, they're trailing 5-2 on opening day 1986. John Shelby, Rick Dempsey, and Jackie Gutierrez due up the 7, 8, and 9 spots in the order. So far, Ken Schramm has really held them in check. The Orioles have had only 5 hits, and all 5 have been singles. And they have all come in different innings. They had one single in each of the first 5 innings of this game, and that's it. Schramm has not walked anybody. Shelby dribbles it foul up the first baseline, and it's one strike. Shelby singled in the second and hit right back to Schramm in the fifth. He's 1-for-2. The Orioles' runs came in the fifth inning. They had one hit in that fifth inning, but the Indians helped them out a little bit by making 3 errors. It's almost like the Indians said, hey, we lost 102 games last year. Why are we still playing so well? The Orioles got 2, but then Schramm got himself out of it. Pitch to Shelby, a wide one for a ball. 1-1 the count. Rich Bordy has worked 5 shutout innings for the Orioles in relief of Flanagan. And Storm Davis continues to throw in the Oriole bullpen now, so maybe Bordy's done for the day. Shelby hits a hard grounder by Tabler and down the right field line. Tabler made a dive for it, couldn't get it. It bounces off the box seat railing and into shallow right field. Carter has to go back to get it. Shelby at second with a stand-up double. Shelby pulled one on the ground and by a diving Tabler right over the bag at first base. It went down into the corner and hit the box seat railing when it comes out right near the foul line. And Carter had been chasing in toward the line for it, had to reverse and go back. So Shelby with a leadoff double, the first extra base hit of the game for the Orioles. Now here is Rick Dempsey. Dempsey has hit a hard grounder to short, and he is single. Now the Cleveland bullpen gets busy again. And Ernie Camacho, who missed almost all of last year, had a couple of different surgeries during the past year. Almost back to 100%, and he is throwing out there, a right-hander. Pitch to Dempsey. Popped off the first base side, foul toward the Cleveland dugout. Tabler goes over. He's got a play, and he makes the catch. And Shelby tags. He's heading for third. The throw over there is off the glove of Jacoby, and Shelby is safe. Tabler was about to fall into the Cleveland dugout, and some very aggressive heads-up base running there by Shelby. Some Indians players reached out and prevented Tabler from falling in. Then he had to turn quickly and throw to third. He bounced it into Jacoby and off his glove. So Dempsey fouls out, but Shelby makes third. And now Earl Weaver will go to the bench. And here is Jim Dwyer to bat for Gutierrez. Jamie Easterly is also up now in the Cleveland bullpen, a left-hander. And Jack Aker, the Cleveland pitching coach, the new pitching coach, is going out to the mound now to visit with Ken Schramm. Boy, Shelby really utilizing the speed there. Tagging up at second base and going to third on a foul pop to the first baseman. So Jim Dwyer, who had more RBIs than any other pinch hitter in the American League last year, trying to deliver a run here as Easterly and Camacho continue to throw in the Cleveland bullpen. Seventh inning, the Orioles are down by three. Dwyer, 4-for-11 in his career against Ken Schramm. The stretch by Schramm and the pitch. Changeup floats through there with a little wrinkle on it for strike one. Dwyer had an excellent spring. He hit 359. He, too, worked out a lot this winter. He went on a very strict program, a regimen of weightlifting and that sort of thing. And he appears to be remade, a much stronger-looking version of Dwyer. Curve in the dirt for a ball, 1-1. Dwyer had a homer and four doubles this spring. Shelby at third, one out in the seventh inning. The Indians infield backed up all the way around and playing Dwyer to pull, except third baseman Jacoby. He's wide of the bag at third, but even with the bag. Shelby with a short lead down the line. Schramm set, delivers, change up very high. And it's 2-1. Alan Wiggins is on deck. The largest regular season crowd in the history of Memorial Stadium and Orioles baseball here today. And now hoping for one of those late afternoon bursts of power. The 2-1 pitch. Swing, fly ball, left field. Hall drifting back in the ball, short of the warning track, and he makes the catch. Here comes Shelby on the tag up, and he scores. And that's a T-bone Shelby run all the way. He got the double, and then he tagged up to get himself to third base. The only reason he's able to score on that is because of the daring base running on that foul ball. Caught by Tabler near the Cleveland dugout. So, 5-3 now. The Orioles draw just a little bit closer. And here is Alan Wiggins. Wiggins has flied to left. He has singled, safe in an error, and stolen a base in this game. Batting left-handed, looks at a high fastball for a strike, 0-1. Wiggins bunted in the fifth inning. Schramm fielded it, threw to first, and the ball was wide of the bag and off the glove of Tabler. He stretched out for it, had it, and dropped it. Wiggins bunts it, but pops it up foul back of the plate. Allenson back, and he makes the catch. Wiggins trying to bunt his way aboard, but he popped it up, and Wiggins very unhappy with that state of affairs. He slams his helmet on the infield grass as he heads out to second base, fouling to the catcher. Scoreboard of the out-of-town game is brought to you by Gwaltney, where Virginia-cured bacon has been a favorite for more than 100 years. Lean and tasty. Make sure to have plenty on hand for your home plate. And Gwaltney Bacon has a special low price this week at all Baltimore cash and carry stores. Here is Rich Borty to face Pat Tabler. The ball is grounded foul, third base side. Borty on since the third inning. Has worked five innings total, allowing no runs and three hits. 5-3, Cleveland ahead. That's the Gwaltney score right now in the eighth inning. Orioles bullpen is busy. Tabler, 0-3 in the game. The pitch, curve, is swung on and missed. Strike two. Dennis Martinez, a right-hander, has started throwing down the Oriole bullpen. Orioles have 10 pitchers on the roster, even with only a 24-man roster. Here's a two-strike delivery. Curveball reached for and looped foul off to the right and into the lower deck. It's 0-2. Juan Bonilla now makes his Orioles debut. He's at third base. He'll hit in the ninth spot after Dwyer was lifted for a pinch hitter. Now time taken. A paper airplane floating by Tabler at home plate. If you see somebody, when you're at the ballpark, throw a paper airplane, turn them in, it puts somebody's eye out. Two-strike delivery. Hit off the hands, a looper into shallow left. Out goes Ripken, but it's over his head, and it falls in for a base hit. Tabler muscled that one right over the infield, his first hit. The Indians eighth, all told, and here is Tony Bernazard. And now, Storm Davis will get up and start throwing again. No, wait a minute, that's Don Ossie now. Storm had been up many times earlier, but now Ossie and left-hander Tippy Martinez will start to throw out there. Boston 6, Detroit 5, last of the eighth inning. Campbell in the eighth for the Tigers in relief of Morris. Throw to first, Tabler back. But now in the last of the eighth, Steve Crawford in for Sammy Stewart, and now Joe Sambito on for Crawford with two on and two out. Still 6-5 Tigers. Last of the eighth. Eighth inning here, 5-3 Cleveland. Pitch to Bernazard, high ball one. Bernazard batting left-handed. He has walked twice and scored a run, but he has struck out looking, 0-1. Murray at first, holding Tabler. Bonilla, the third baseman, shallow. Ripken and Wiggins both edged toward the middle and in a few feet. Double play depth. Mel Hall on deck. Throw to first, Tabler back. Milwaukee with two in the sixth, and in so doing, knocking Tom Seaver out of the box. Dave Schmidt is on in relief. It's 5-2 Brewers after 5.5. Ground ball to Murray at first. Hits his knee, bounces to Wiggins at second. He picks it up, throws back to Murray in time. And Bernazard is out. The only unfortunate aspect of that is that had Eddie been able to field the ball cleanly, it might have been a double play. And at least he would have gotten the lead runner. But the ball kicked off the edge of his glove and then hit off his knee and right over to Wiggins to play 3-4-3. Here is Mel Hall. In the lineup only because the misfortune of Carmen Castillo, who pulled a calf muscle during batting practice. Hall has driven in two runs. Ground ball to second. Wiggins picks it up. Throws to first for the out. Down to third base goes Tabler. And here is Andy Allenson, the rookie catcher from Richmond, Virginia. Base hits in his first two big league at-bats. A single in the second, a single in the third. And then trying to bunt his way aboard in the sixth, he was thrown out by Borty. Got an infield hit in the third. He really moves. He had excellent speed. 5-3 Cleveland, two out of the eight. Borty from the stretch, delivers. Curve outside, ball one. Ninth inning in Cincinnati, the Reds 7, the Phillies 4. Robinson in relief of Soto there. After one inning in Los Angeles, no score, the Padres and the Dodgers. Schau and Valenzuela. Tabler down the line from third. Borty from the stretch, looks over at him. Now throws. Curve outside. 2-0 the count. Dempsey takes the mask off, walks out to talk to Borty now. Andy Allenson, in 3 years in the minor leagues, never hit a home run. That's an 870 professional at-bats. But in the Instructional League in Florida this past October, he hit 4 home runs. 2-0 pitch. Curveball. There's a called strike. Dempsey came up, bluffing the throw to third, and Tabler took him seriously, went hurtling back into third with a headlong dive. 2-1 the count. The pitch on the way. Curve! Swung on and missed. 2-2. Change speeds in that curveball. And Allenson way out in front of it. 2-2 the count. Brett Butler would be next. Eighth inning. Ossie and Tippy Martinez throwing in the bullpen. And the pitch. There's a pop-up foul off the first base side. This one will drop back into the grandstands. And the count 2-2. Tomorrow a day off, although the Orioles will play their Hagerstown Farm Club. Scott McGregor will pitch that game. And then Wednesday back here, 4 o'clock, the second opener. The Orioles and the Indians. Boddicker versus Neil Heaton. The 2-2 pitch on the way. There's a squibber toward the middle. Ripken to his left. He gloves it. He turns. He throws to first. And it skips by Murray and goes into the Cleveland dugout. Coming in to score is Tabler. And Allenson will go to second. Either way, it's a hit and a run batted in for Allenson. But the error to Ripken allowing him to go to second base. Cal ordinarily might not have taken a chance on that kind of a play. For that very reason, the risk of throwing it away. But in this instance, he figured the risk was worth it because if he gets the man, it saves a run. And of course, Allenson's speed will surprise you. He's had 2 infield hits in this game out of his 3. Fine play by Ripken keeping it from going to center. So it's 6-3 now, and here's Brett Butler. He bunts it, but foul off to the left, 0-1. Bonilla coming hard down the line from third when he saw the square of the bunt. The Orioles giving up this run, and again, you go back to the would-be double play ball that hit off Murray's glove. Bordy might have been out of the inning before Allenson even came up had they been able to get the double play. It is an earned run, however. Fastball high, 1-1. The first allowed by Bordy. First final score of the year. Cincinnati has defeated Philadelphia 7-4 at Riverfront Stadium. Pitch, curveball, lined into right field, right to Lacey, and he makes the catch. So Butler 0-4 on the day with a walk. A run, 2 hits, 1 error, 1 left. We go to the last of the 8th. The Orioles are trailing 6-3. Last of the 8th inning. The Orioles coming up, and they've got the big hitters coming up, trailing 6-3 to the Cleveland Indians. This is John Miller along with Tom Marr. And before the largest regular season crowd in Orioles history since their entrance into the American League, 1954, the Orioles trailing nonetheless. We're hoping now for some of those late inning miracles here. As Ken Schramm, who's been so tough, goes to work, the Indians' bullpen is already busy. Left-hander, Jamie Easterly, and right-hander, Ernie Camacho up. Meanwhile, they have gone to the 9th inning in Detroit, checking the Gwaltney scoreboard, and Willie Hernandez has come on to try and save a 6-5 Tiger victory. Tigers leading 6-5 against the Red Sox after 8-4. Here's the pitch now to Lee Lacey. Ground ball down the third baseline. It's a fair ball. This one heading into the left field corner. Ball will play the carom off the wall, and Lacey around first and on his way to second with a stand-up double. So Lee Lacey picking on the first pitch from Schramm and pulling it right along the third base line. Jacoby made a dive for it, but never got that close. And Lacey with his 2nd hit of the day. He earlier had singled. Grounded into a double play and popped out. Now he's 2-for-4, and here is Ripken. Ripken and Murray. Neither one has had a hit against Schramm. and both have had good success against him in years past. Ripken has flied to center, rolled out to the catcher, and has been called out on strikes. The pitch. Curve is low, ball one. Detroit has defeated Boston, 6-5. Hernandez getting the save, and the Tigers have won it despite four Red Sox homers. Here, 6-3, Cleveland, last of the eighth. The stretch by Schraub, and the pitch to Ripken. Called a strike in the inside. Cal turns and says something to Brinkman. Cal called out on a pitch similar to that in the fifth inning. Cal stands well off the plate, and when a pitch comes well inside, he feels that should be a ball because he's that far off the plate. That's the reason he stands so far off the plate. It makes it hard to jam him. One ball, one strike. Lacy leads from second. Here's the stretch. And the pitch on the way. Swung on and swatted foul. He pulled it right outside the third baseline, right by his father. And down the left field line. One ball, two strikes. The Orioles have seven hits against Schramm. Schramm has not walked anybody. On the other side of the ledger, the Orioles have walked five Indians. And three of those walks turned into runs. One and two the count. Now time taken. Ripken backs away. Eddie Murray awaiting on deck. The sun is shining on Memorial Stadium once again. Here's the pitch. And he throws a slider outside. Cal wouldn't bite. Two and two. Ripken could get aboard. Eddie Murray would come up with a chance to tie the game. Schramm taking his time. He's on top. Looks back at Lacy. Here comes. Swing and a foul back to the screen. He jammed him. This time Ripken went after it. Got a piece of it to stay alive. Two and two. The shadows now covering the left side of the infield from the pitcher's mound over to the line and curving out to shortstop. The right side of the infield is still in the sunshine. All three of the outfielders in the sunshine, although left fielder Mel Hall is right on the edge of the shadows. The pitcher standing in the sun, the batter in the shadows. Two and two the count. The pitch. Ripken loops it into shallow left field. And it falls. Base hit. Here comes Lacy. He's going to be waved home. Mel Hall throws to second. And Lacy scores standing up. It's 6-4. Time at bats against Schramm has hit three home runs. We'll probably not get a chance to do so here. And of course, Corrales, figuring Murray much more dangerous as a left-hand batter, has a lefty, Easterly ready, and he's going to him. It's 6-4 Cleveland, last of the eighth, and while Easterly comes in, let's pause for these words. Jamie Easterly to make Eddie Murray switch around and bat right-handed. 6-4 is the score. Cleveland on top, but now that lead is in some jeopardy. Easterly on a relief of Schramm. Schramm went seven innings plus, allowing four runs, only two of which were earned on eight hits. Two strikeouts, he never walked anybody. Now, here we are into a late inning pressure situation. And Eddie Murray, last year in this kind of a spot, his team trailing, but in a situation where he could either put them ahead or tie a ball game while he was up there. Murray with runners on in a late inning pressure spot last year hit 567. 17 for 30 with four home runs. And against Easterly, in his career, Murray is 4 for 11 with two doubles, but he has never homered against Easterly. Freddie Lynn is on deck. Ripken at first, nobody out in the eighth inning. 6-4 Cleveland. Camacho, a right-hander, still throwing in the Indian bullpen. And now Scott Bales, a rookie left-hander, has joined him. Here is Murray. He is 0 for 3. Ripken at first. Tabler holding him on. Easterly throws. The ball is dribbled back toward the mound. Easterly has it, and he'll go to first for the shore out. Ball just wasn't hit that hard. Ripken goes down to second, and Murray is gone on one pitch. Eddie has not gotten the ball out of the infield today. Grounding to second, twice popping out, and now a dribbler back toward the mound. And here is Freddie Lynn. Now, Freddie, against Easterly, only 2 for 15 in his career. So Easterly is a very good choice to face Freddie Lynn. The Indians' first baseman, Tabler, guarding the first baseline against the extra base hit, and he's back on the outfield grass. Left fielder Mel Hall is way over into left center. Base hit could mean a run here. 6-4 in the eighth with one out. Easterly delivers. The pitch, a half swing and an accidental foul. Hitting off the facade of the upper deck and bouncing all the way back down onto the field, right to third base coach Cal Ripken. Mike Young is on deck. Freddie Lynn has flied to center. He has singled and fouled to third in this game. 1-3. Easterly, probably the only really consistently successful Indians pitcher a year ago. He looks back at Ripken, delivers. Swing and a shot, foul outside of third. Hit it hard, but late. Very much foul over toward the seats. It's 0-2. Six runs, nine hits with three errors for the Indians. The Orioles have four runs, eight hits with two errors. The Orioles, who led the majors in home runs last year, have not hit any today. In fact, they've only had two doubles and six singles, and that's their total output. Here's the stretch. Two strike pitch on the way. In the dirt, Allinson boxes it, keeps it in front of him. The count now 1-2. Easterly, been around a long time. 33 years old from Houston, Texas. Did some starting last year, but was very successful as a reliever. 4-1 overall. Worked in 50 games for the Indians. A 392 earned run average. 1-2 to Lynn. Here it comes. Swing and a miss. Sidearm curveball, and Freddie chased a bad one. Two down, and now Mike Young comes up. Switch hitter, he'll bat right-handed. And now here comes Jack Aker, the Cleveland pitching coach, again. Now, Young, of course, is a very pronounced home run threat. The man on deck, John Shelby, not so much of a home run threat. Aker out to have a few words with Jamie Easterly. Mike Young in this kind of a spot last year, late inning pressure kind of a spot, hit 300 for the Orioles. Young, switch hitter, he'll bat right-handed. Now Aker goes back to the dugout. Ripken at second, but two men gone now. And the stretch by Easterly. Young standing in, the pitch. Fastball misses inside, ball one. Young did his best hitting against lefties a year ago. Hit 293. And had a homer every 15 at-bats against lefties. Hit 260s against the right-handers. 6-4 Cleveland, last of the eighth. The 1-0 pitch. Fastball is high, 2-0. It keeps showing him the fastball, but just out of the strike zone. Young has shown patience and has refused to help Easterly out. It's 2-0. Shelby, who's had two hits today, awaiting on deck. Ripken, who drove in a run with a single in this inning, leading from second. Cleveland infield playing Young to pull, except Tabler guarding the line at first. The pitch, low curveball, misses. Ball three. Now, if you're Earl Weaver, what do you say to Mike Young? He's the possible tying run, a great home run threat. you say go ahead on 3-0. Young has gotten the word from Ripken, the third base coach, and now he stands back in there. Down in a crouch. Standing toward the front of the box, slightly open stance. Now Easterly steps off the rubber. Young will back away. Mike has rounded a second, struck out and grounded a first. He's 0 for 3. 3-0 the count. The pitch on the way. Fastball is low. He walked it. So, perhaps an unintentional intentional walk. He pitched around him all the way. Never very far out of the strike zone.
Left fielder.
Now here is Shelby.
Shelby.
Shelby showed some pop in the bat last year. Today he's got himself a couple of hits, a single in the second. He hit back to the pitcher in the fifth, and he doubled along the right field line in the seventh. 2 for 3 for Shelby. Ripken at second, Young at first, both ready to go in anything. Easterly to Shelby. Ground ball pulled foul, third base side, and it is one strike. Last of the eighth, Cleveland 6, the Orioles 4. With two down, of course, Mike Young able to get a bigger jump away from first base, and the crack of the bat, he'll take off, giving him a little better of a chance to score the tying run on an extra base hit. Easterly at the belt, delivers, swing and a miss, and Shelby helped him on that one. Pitch down around his shins, and it's 0-2. Rick Dempsey out on deck. Ripken edges away from second. Young with a long lead from first. The Cleveland infield backed up all the way around. Easterly's two-strike pitch, here it comes. Curve down and in. Shelby gets back out of the way of it. One ball, two strikes. Now Easterly toes the rubber. Allinson wigwags his sign to him. The left-hander set. The 1-2 pitch to Shelby. In the dirt, the ball bounces away from Allinson. And over to the seats to the right of home. Ripken to third and Young to second. And we'll see now what, if any, significance this wild pitch will have. All of a sudden, just a base hit could tie this game. A moment ago, it would have taken an extra base hit. So there they are for Shelby to pick up. The man who finished his spring in such a red-hot streak to get himself a start on opening day. And now, just a base hit from his bat to put the Orioles even with the Indians, whom they have trailed throughout the afternoon since the first inning. The stretch, the 2-2 pitch. Swing and a ground ball, foul on the third base side. So we'll try it again. 2-2 to Shelby. Easterly rubs up the new ball, walking back in the grass behind the mound. Shelby with his feet wide apart in a closed stance, crowding the plate. Allinson with his sign. The stretch. Easterly comes into Shelby. Very high with a fastball. And now Allinson takes time and runs out to talk to Easterly. Says something very briefly. Easterly nods his head as he takes the ball back from him. Now Easterly walks back right over the top of the hill and back onto the grass again. Takes a deep breath. 3-2 to Shelby. Camacho, the right-hander, bails the left-hander, throwing in the Indians' bullpen. Easterly again, towing the rubber, getting the sign from Allinson. He has it. He's ready. And the pitch. In the dirt inside, ball four, and the bases are loaded for Dempsey. here comes Corrales. Dempsey, 1-for-3 in this game and 4-for-10 lifetime against Easterly. And Corrales is going to make a move for his right-hander, Ernie Camacho. And we'll see if this prompts a counter move from Earl Weaver. And right away on opening day, the problems that Earl was expressing about being a move shy, well, those problems loom a little bit larger because the Orioles only have three men left on the bench.
Let's pause now for station identification. This is the Orioles Radio Network.
Orioles Magic, back in 1986 on Maryland sports leader WFBR Baltimore.
Ernie Camacho is ready. The bases are loaded for Rick Dempsey. John?
Dempsey, 1-for-3 against Camacho, for whatever that's worth. Ripken at third, Young at second, Shelby at first. 6-4 Cleveland. And here's Dempsey trying to deliver the big hit, the pitch. Fastball at the knees, called a strike. 0-1. Dempsey last year hit .325 against lefties, .200 against right-handers. The biggest difference of that kind of any hitter in the league. But it's coming off a fine spring. Here's the pitch. There's a high pop-up towards shortstop. Franco drifting to his left and out into shallow center, and he makes the catch, and the side is retired. So the Orioles leave three. They get one run, two hits, and after eight falls, 6-4 Cleveland. 6-4 in this one. As Rick Dempsey popping out against Ernie Camacho. And Dempsey fighting something that's almost like a curse. He came up against Camacho with two out and the bases loaded. And since 1981, Dempsey has gone 0-for-17 when he's batted with two outs and the bases loaded. And in 11 years, or most of his career, since those records started being kept, Dempsey has had three hits in 46 bases loaded two-out situations. Here is Joe Carter. Carter has doubled, lined to second, struck out, and popped to the catcher. 1-for-4, right-hand batter. Ossie delivers, and a fastball is a wide one. One ball and no strikes. Ossie, who had great success after Earl Weaver became manager last year, won 10 ball games, saved 14 a year ago. Fastball for a strike on the outside. Ossie got the win on opening day last year against the Texas Rangers. One ball, one strike to Carter. It comes. Fastball called, strike two. Franco and Thornton to follow. Rich Bordy, 81 pitches, pitching six innings, allowing one run and five hits. Struck out three, walked two. The 1-2 pitch, slider outside for a ball, 2-2. Ossie had a pretty good spring for the Orioles, although despite a 1.38 earned run average down in Florida, he said he didn't pitch all that well. Pitch is reached for and lofted foul off to the right into the upper deck. 2-2. Ossie saying that just didn't feel like he mechanically was throwing the ball very well. Two and two the count. Here's his pitch to Carter. There's a pop foul. This one will drift back and into the upper deck. 2-2. Here's the pitch. Curve outside, ball three. From about the time that Weaver became the manager until the end of September last year, Ossie went 5-3 with 12 saves and a 1.78 earned run average. Pitch fouled off to the right and into the upper deck, 3-2. And prior to that, he just hadn't been used very often. His earned run average when Earl got here was over 7. 6-4, Cleveland, ninth inning. Here's the 3-2 pitch. Popped up. Foul ground. First base side. Murray over to the seats and reaches in. Did he get it? Nope. 3-2. Just beyond his reach. And we check the flags, and the wind has shifted again. It is again blowing in from left. And that wind just blew an out a few inches away from Murray's glove. Started the day blowing in like that. And midway through the game, it started blowing out toward left field. Now it's switched around again, although we've got blue skies in the late afternoon overhead. 3-2 pitch. Popped up into shallow center. Out goes Ripken, the shortstop. Lynn coming in from center, but Ripken is under it, and he makes the catch. Ossie gets Carter. One down. Here is Julio Franco. Franco, the right-hand batting shortstop, has grounded a third. He has doubled and scored a run. Started a two-run third-inning rally with a double. He has grounded a short, and he has walked. Caught trying to steal in the seventh inning. He's 1-for-3 officially. Here's the windup by Ossie, the pitch. Fastball right there, strike one. When the Orioles come to bat in the ninth inning, they're due to have Juan Bonilla, Alan Wiggins, and Lee Lacy coming up. Curve low for a ball. And if anybody gets on base, the Orioles will then have Ripken up. And then get two men on base, Eddie Murray would get a chance. The pitch. Slider breaks down for a ball, 2-1. The 2-1 pitch. Strike two, a beauty. A fastball on the outside corner at the knees. 2-2. Two and two the count to Julio Franco. Here's Ossie's windup, the pitch. Ground ball down the first baseline. Murray to his left. He gets it and runs to the bag, beating Franco there for out number two. That one was really a squibber. Had some strange action on it as it was bouncing up the first baseline and further toward the line all the while. And Murray, of course, plays well wide of the bag. And had to go a long way to get to it, but finally did for the unassisted out. And here is Andre Thornton. Thornton has driven in a run with an infield out. He has walked and scored a run. Grounded to Gutierrez, who made a great play on him in the fourth, and he struck out into a double play in the seventh. Swings here and fouls one back onto the screen, 1-1. So Thornton, 0-for-3 with a run batted in. The Indians took the lead on that RBI in the first. And the Indians got two more in the second, two more in the third. And led all the way through it. One strike pitch, fastball called, strike two. The Orioles got two in the fifth and one in the seventh, but then the Indians got that one back in the eighth. The Orioles came back with one in their half of the eighth to make it 6-4. The pitch, outside for a ball, 1-2. Jacoby on deck. And the pitch. There's a high pop-up back to third and foul ground. Bonilla and Ripken going for it over near the seats, and now Ripken takes charge and he makes the catch. Bonilla was dancing around under it, and Ripken, who's about a foot taller than Bonilla, was just standing right under it near the seats, and he caught it as Bonilla was bounding around beneath him there somewhere. So the inning is over. Last chance for the Orioles. Bottom of the ninth inning from Memorial Stadium. This is John Miller along with Tom Marr. Ernie Camacho trying to wrap it up for the Indians. Camacho, who in 1984 had 23 saves for the Indians, which is an all-time Indians record. And then twice last year, he had surgery. He started the year and then early on was out of commission. April the 13th, had a bone chip removed from his right elbow. And then on a Halloween this past fall, he underwent a second operation. But now he's back. Corrales says he's not throwing as hard as he was. But he's still throwing pretty hard. Here's Bonilla to lead it off against him. The pitch. Fastball is high. Ball one. Jim Kern is another fellow who's come off some arm surgery. And pitched well enough in the spring to make the ball club. And he is now throwing in the Cleveland bullpen. Bonilla looks at a called strike in the count 1-1. Bonilla, right-hand batter, has hit as high as 290 in the big leagues. 260 lifetime average, the 1-1 pitch. Ground ball hit slowly on the right side of the infield. Tabler over to get it, underhands to Camacho, covering, and it works for the out. Bonilla is out, and now Alan Wiggins. Again, Ripken would be due up fourth in the inning, and Murray fifth. Detroit has defeated Boston 6-5. Kirk Gibson, 4-for-4 with 5 RBIs in that game, 2 homers. And information posted up on the Diamond Vision board. Don Baylor in his Red Sox debut went 3-for-4 with a home run. Pitch to Wiggins. Strike on the outside, 0-1. Wiggins, 1-for-4, a single, a stolen base. Batting left-handed, the pitch. Strike 2 called at the knees. Wiggins has twice attempted to bunt for a hit. Safe in an error on one of them, and he fouled to the catcher on the other. The 2-strike pitch on the way. Fastball just outside for a ball. 1-2. Lacey on deck. 6 runs, 9 hits for Cleveland. 4 runs, 8 hits for the Orioles. Camacho works quickly, comes back. Swung on and hit high and foul down the left field line, back into the crowd. 1-2. Jim Kern throwing in the Cleveland bullpen, a right-hander. First sign of trouble. Corrales has already said he'll go to Kern to wrap up a ball game. The pitch, very wide for a ball, 2-2. Fastball missing high and away. The outfield over toward the left field line. Shallow, the pitch. Again, hit high and foul. This off the third base side and about halfway up into the upper deck. 2-2. Camacho right back to him. And Wiggins fouls this one back onto the netting. Back toward the press box, 2-2. Commissioner of Baseball, Peter Ueberroth, here today. And sitting now over in Edward Bennett Williams' private box. 2-2 pitch, and he fouls this one off. Wiggins really making him work. Fouls this one off the left field line, back into the lower deck. Still 2-2. Indians really bunched up on the left side of the infield for Wiggins. The pitch, strike 3 called in the inside corner. Two down in the ninth, and here is Lee Lacey.
Right fielder, Lee Lacey.
Wiggins unhappy with that call, but and he goes back to the dugout. Two men down, here's Lacey. Lacey has singled, grounded into a double play, popped out, and he doubled in the eighth. Scored a run. He's 2-for-4 on opening day. Camacho into the windup, and the pitch. Swing and a miss. He busted the fastball right by him. One strike to count. Now the windup, the one strike delivery. There's a pop foul. This one will land out of play on the first base side, back into the box seats. Hands on over in that section, still in the sunshine. In the deeper reaches of the outfield, the sun is shining. The rest of the field is in the shadows. And the 2-strike, 2-out pitch swung on, and he just got a piece of it and fouled it back onto the net. 0-2. The largest crowd in regular season history to see an Orioles game at Memorial Stadium, and now very quiet. Ripken on deck, but the Orioles have just one last gasp of breath left to them now. Camacho again to Lacey. Swing and a miss. He struck him out with a high fastball. And now it's all over. And Camacho, in his first appearance of the year, getting a save, his first since his big year of 2 years ago. And so the Orioles, who were in a big hole early, although they come close, fall short.